thing about it is that as opposed to silence and as opposed to Irishmen, which Irishmen with Pablo and ILM was sort of revolutionary in terms of the youthification of De Niro, Pacino, and Pesci, and what that took, the technology and the expertise and the respect for the artistry of the actors. Because as I say, in a case like that, you know, if he his eye moves if his eye twitches and then we youthify them, the twitching of the eye changes the meaning of the dialogue. And we have to figure out then how to fix the twitch to match the original one, but still is youthful. So all of this kind of very, very fine one hair paintbrush work that Pablo and his team did. In a case like this, I thought when I went out to Oklahoma, I felt that, you know, I'm a New Yorker. I've never been in places like that. I mean, if I have, it's been for one day. But when I saw the prairies and I get a sense of space, probably you could elaborate on this, but the idea that I had was that in a way we have to respect the landscape and we have to make it fit. And the landscape is there. The story takes place in that landscape, but we have to respect that landscape and how it addresses the story. And the landscape is not just rolling hills or prairies. It's an atmosphere. You know, you could say a tree, but there are many different thousands of trees. And so everything has a dramatic element and it adds to the narrative. You know, if you have a beautiful flourishing tree, or, you know, it didn't seem to work in those areas, especially with the Ramsey you know, Henry Rome, where the first day of shooting, when he takes him out there and he shoots him. I remember we were playing around with changing some of the trees in the background. And it doesn't mean everything has to be bleak, but there was a sense of place that we had to be true to. Now, Pablo, you could pick up on that.
No, definitely. I mean, I think a lot has to do with how you approach the work that we do. I mean, definitely, you said he had to be invisible, and I also made it my business to be invisible, to let you do whatever you do. And I always take it, you know, kind of a back approach, and I always listen a lot. And one of the things that you're great at is getting all the departments, all the department heads, and give us references and a sense of, you know, atmosphere and what is it that we're all trying to do. We take a look at reference pictures, but we also take a look at the footage. And a lot of it also is in the script. And we all discuss that. And so when you, so what that does is sets up everybody to run in the same direction and everybody to push your vision. I think you're such an instinctive and visual filmmaker that it inspires us all to do exactly what you want us to do.
Well, again, in a case like that, I gave myself over to the environment, to the land. And if in the background, well, they needed some hills to replicate a sense of what Fairfax Town was in 1921, and we can add a few hills in just as a reference point, or take away some of the hills that were there because it's really Pawhuska and we're making it double for Fairfax. You know what I'm saying? It's that kind of work that was very subtle, but I have to say that when you see the result, it is not shocking, but a major difference. In other words, I know that there were trees there. Okay, there are no trees now, but they were there in 1921. So in other words, I could feel it. You know, I could feel that now we're getting back to what this place may have looked like in 1921, you know. But I'm used to seeing it every day. So when I see something that he does, I say, oh, wait a minute. Oh, I see. Ah, okay. That's based on this photograph. That's based on this. That's based on what's written, et cetera, and all these other. So it was really subtle, more subtle than what we did in Silence, and certainly more subtle than what we did in Irishman.
You know? It is. It is. But you have a very subtle eye, though. And for you, I can see that it's all about how you feel about the picture. Yeah. And also how you felt on the day when you made those, you know, those performances happen. And I'm always trying to get with the program and understand, you know, how you come about things. I would never, I mean, but you also are very daring, though. You're somebody who loves to experiment. You know,
yes.
In some instances, like I remember the scene in which Molly's sick and she's looking out the window and she's with Ernest in the room, and there were some fires outside.
Yes, that was a big.
But you explain we're seeing the inside of her and her point of view, and she's about to die, or she thinks she's about to die. And it's just incredible the way you are able to experiment with that and giving us visual effects artists the inside of what it is that you're trying to make without your direction.
Yeah, and I think that particular scene, the impression of what was outside those windows, it was an impression. It wasn't meant to be totally realistic, and it wasn't meant to be totally abstract. It is an element of hallucination. And so it took us a while, didn't it, to get that right between what Rodrigo did and what we did on set, and then what we did in the editing and post-production with you. So I think we got it. It suggests her state of mind, or the emotional and psychological state of all of them at that point in the story. It suggests that. It's as if you're in that room and you've been in there sick for weeks, and then they're giving you medicine which has got some element in it that is damaging you, and you're starting to see reality not as reality anymore. You know, you might get more clear-minded as to the danger you're in, but you may not even be able to speak, you see. So what does that do to your vision, you know? And we imply that with the flames outside, with the men and the silhouettes against the burning prairie, which was basically done. I think we did it that was done on set. That was done with a fire rod or whatever it is. And we took the ripples from the flames and put it in front of the lens. And so we wanted to create that effect in the windows, but through her experience, you know. So it's a little off, but it's not totally abstract, and it's not completely realistic, because quite honestly, the house where they were supposed to have been, and they would never have seen that fire.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But the whole company, the whole movie's on fire by that point. The whole story's on fire, you know?
There you go. You see, that's how you tie everything into it. The whole story's on fire.
The whole story.
We're just seeing from inside of her. So you just went from inside of her into the whole story.
Yeah.
And I think also your approach to visual effects is always, you started with the performance, obviously, and your direction, and also the lighting. And then we came in and we, you know, helped. So it's not just a CG environment and a CG. That's your approach to visual effects. It's not just visual effects. It's visual effects working with other, you know, with everybody else.
Other elements, And we had some, obviously, some issues with where I needed a lot of help with special effects, and that is the overhead shots, or the moving, it used to be helicopter shots, now it's a drone, but entering Bill Hale's ranch with those cows, that cattle, you know. When I got on the set, there was a herd of cattle, and then they were off on the right, and I said, well, we need them over here. Later, we'll be shooting this way, and then people pointed out to me, no, they see the cattle graze, and when they graze, they keep moving. So by 4 o'clock, when we're ready for that shot, they'll be over here, not there. And I said, See, I didn't know that. As a New Yorker, I didn't, you know what I mean? So at that point, we realized, okay, we're going to have to, I want a camera flying over cows and cattle and cattle and cattle to the house, you know? And that's where, of course, some wonderful CGI came in to help at that point.
Yes. Then we also help with the, you know, with the last, you know, the dance, the Osage dance, you know.
Oh, God, yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Last sequence.
But I thought personally that it was incredible the way you think about a shot, because we started, remember, with the previous very, very roughly. And you're also able to just take a look at some stick figures and just figure it out. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And there was that exploration of what happens. The camera, well, the camera is pulling out, but does it pull out straight up, or does
Yes, I forgot about that. Yeah.
But do we see the faces of them?
We went back after shooting and shot that scene because we couldn't do it at that time because of COVID. There were just too many people.
Right.
And so we had to wait a little while longer. We flew back to Oklahoma and we did it. But you're right, it was directly up. and we worked it out as to how ultimately it should be, like a circle in the center of the frame, like a heart or, you know, beating of civilization, so to speak, of humanity. The abstraction of the last image comes from something very real. Well, of course, don't forget I was there when it was created. I was walking around the place and I saw the Death Star and I saw all these things, you know. And I always wondered, how would I ever be able to fit in to the technology, you know? I never quite expected me to be using this technology, or utilizing it, I should say, in a way that is dramatic and that allows me to make the kind of film that I normally would make, but with, in some cases, you know, where I'm doing a double camera, let's say, the dialogue between the two actors, let's say Pacino and De Niro in a hotel room, is so special. I wanted to get it directly in line, both cameras, but we're photographing each other's camera. And to have the ability just to erase that camera is a real, I'll say I'm doing it. I don't care, I'm doing it. That along with the understanding of, you know, I was introduced to ILM on the level of Star Wars, so I never thought I would do anything with Star Wars. So how could that technology help me? But it took about 10 years, 15 years for me to slowly come around to it, with George Lucas pointing out to me, Morty, you could do this, Morty, you could do that. And I never quite got it until I think we were doing, I think Aviator, and then finally another, the 3D film, Hugo. But primarily, you know, to take Taiwan, for example, and make it Kyushu, or take Taiwan and make it Portugal, Macau in the 17th century. This was a blessing because, first of all, I've been to Macau. There's nothing there that resembles anything of the 17th century except the facade of the church and the steps. The steps are there. That's it. The rest is gone. It's all gambling. So, you know, the big issue for me has always been, how does the technology serve me rather than me serving the technology? That's all. It just happens to be that way. And I must say, I came to it through ILM, through George, and through working a little bit on the other films, yes, true, but really with ILM, because I came to feel it very comfortable with it, you know, and not feel that I'm cutting corners in any way, or if I really feel we have to go out in the middle of the prairie, we go out in the middle of the prairie, you know, that's it. In New York, I got to feel we're shooting this way, but that building's, then we're going to have to do it. Or I know that worst comes to worst, I can always paint that out. And so it's given me a freedom that still allows me to hang on to, or to mine the territory that I normally would in my movies, which is something I never thought would happen, quite honestly.
Yes, I have to say it's very rare to see a filmmaker that visual and instinctive and willing to experiment like you. And also, you know what, it points out to the trust, because I do feel the trust.
Well, I'd look at you and I'd say, I know you could do it. Then all you got to do is explain to me the parameters. I say, oh, okay, well, we'll take one of these, you know, show it to me, explain it to me. And we've gone through this process for the past 8 years or so. So it's really been something.
Yes.